they don't have a shield.
What?
Yeah, I don't have a shield.
Where is it?
Oh,
it's right by the radiator. Maybe a half a foot, a second, and it looks like straight sand from the radiator angle.
We copy and we see it.
While on a 6.5-hour spacewalk on the International Space Station in 2017, astronauts Peggy Whitson and Shane Kimbrough experienced a bit of clumsiness that would pose no problems on Earth, but can cause some major headaches in space. They dropped a piece of debris shield that was part of the docking port, a fabric covering that weighed 8 kilograms and measured 162 centimeters by 59 centimeters, about the size of a car door. And that debris shield had an important role to play. It was supposed to cover a docking port on the ship, protecting it from extreme temperature changes and orbital debris, something the ISS could not do without. The shield was a Whipple shield that uses the hypervelocity of space debris to its advantage, using thin layers of shield to obliterate the debris into tiny fragments that the inner shield can withstand as the energy of the debris is spread out over a larger distance. Back on Earth, the mission control team got to work. Thanks to the fact that they had replicas of everything in space, every nut and bolt, and every piece of fabric, mission control found a way for Whitson and Kimbrough to use wire ties and a different piece of cloth as a substitute for the lost Whipple shield, until a replacement could be sent up on another rocket. Having dealt with the problem, there was one more thing to worry about: whether that lost piece of shield would come slamming back into the space station. The shield was monitored closely for two orbits before it was determined that there was no risk it would hit the ISS. Kimbrough and Whitson could breathe a sigh of relief, and Whitson could properly celebrate having completed the most spacewalks of any woman. But just how common is it for astronauts to lose grip on tools and other objects while in the microgravity of space? How costly are these brief bouts of butterfingers on the ISS? And what happens if the newly made space debris is on a collision course with the station or another satellite? These are all scenarios NASA and the astronauts themselves have to prepare for. Like anything else, sometimes accidents happen. The lost shield wasn't the first time astronauts have lost something in the swirl of space while conducting an extravehicular activity, or spacewalk. In 2006, astronaut Pierre Seller dropped a spatula while doing work on the space station, and apparently had a lot of spatulas waiting for him in his office when he came back to Earth after the mission. That same year, another astronaut lost a camera. And in 2008, another astronaut was dealing with a grease gun explosion when she lost a tool bag.
Oh, great. We have a lost tool.
Part of the reasons items can become lost is because of the challenge of maneuvering small objects while wearing massive gloves. Astronaut Drew Feustel has gone to space three times for a total of 226 days and conducted nine spacewalks, accumulating the second longest amount of EVA time among US astronauts. He's pretty familiar with the difficulty of doing work in a bulky 160 kilogram spacesuit.
I equate it to wearing a set of mechanics gloves with welding gloves on top. You know, that's how it feels, getting tactile feedback through your fingertips and through your hands. It's not really a good way to train that except to expose yourself to that environment.
And the way NASA has astronauts practice in advance of going to space is by wearing their suits in a massive pool, which has a precise recreation of the ISS built underwater for the astronauts to practice on. They learn how to maneuver in their suits, how to manipulate tools for repair work, how to move objects from one area to another, and how to perform an emergency rescue on team members, all while still on the planet. It's a pretty good analog, but not everyone gets as much time to practice as they might like.
Historically, during the shuttle era, space shuttle era, when we were flying to space, we would train about a 10 to 1 ratio, meaning we'd practice a technique or a task 10 times underwater for every single time we saw it in space. So for every hour of work in space, we'd have about 10 hours in the pool underwater training those tasks. And that allows you to really build that knowledge of what you can expect the feedback to be through your hands as you're working with the objects in space. We see much less of that now. We're probably closer to a 2 to 3 to 1 ratio, if that. So it's more difficult to have that exposure, and it becomes a challenge.
The astronauts have a number of safeguards for themselves and all their hardware once they're outside the station doing an EVA. They're always attached to small tethers on retractable reels that are either 17 meters or 26 meters long, which will self-retract, allowing the astronauts to move around without fear of drifting too far. On top of that, they have small local tethers that only extend about 1.5 meters, which keep them close enough to the station that they can use both hands for specific activities. But they still have a little more room to maneuver. Then there are all the other tethers for the tools, bags, and whatever other gear they might be carrying.
We always attempt to make sure that every single item that goes outside of the airlock with us has some attachment to something. And that's achieved through those tethers. We are not always successful in keeping those tethers attached. And it's always a little bit scary when you find yourself holding an object and you realize that there's no tether attached to it, either because it was bumped off or it came off accidentally, or in some cases it was never attached in the first place. I've had a couple of experiences with holding items that didn't have tethers on that I expected to have tethers on, and those are the times when you very carefully reach down and find a tether somewhere, anywhere, to connect back to that thing.
But on one particular occasion, during his ninth spacewalk in March 2018, Feustel lost hold of an object. He'd been working to install cameras and wireless communication equipment next to a docking port, as well as securing a loose component on a solar array blanket box, when he lost a wire tie, what he describes as something like a big garbage tie. When he'd pulled the tether to which the wire was attached, it turned out that the jaws of it were still open, and the tie quickly floated away.
There have been crew members in the past who have lunged after objects. You could maybe do that. If you have a short tether on, you're not going to lunge very far. If you have a long tether on and you lunge, you're going to travel for another 55 or 85 feet before that tether hopefully stops you from your motion. And you may or may not have been successful at reaching the object that is now floating away from you. But in my case, I was attached to a foot restraint, which means my feet were fixed. There was really no way for me to move, and I simply watched this object, once I realized it was gone, just float away from me. And at that time, all you can really do is call Mission Control and say, I've lost an object, and this is what it was, and this is how large it is, and this is the direction it's traveling, and this is how fast I think it's going. And then that data gets reported to our tracking officers at Mission Control, and then that gets reported pretty much around the entire space debris network, which exists not only in the U.S. but internationally, to track items that are floating in space that are not really controlled in any way.
Just as with the piece of dropped shield in 2017, NASA had to closely monitor the trajectory of the little wire tie. And in this case, despite the object being much smaller, it ended up being more of a problem.
What I was told after my the loss of my wire tie is that for the first time in history, a satellite had to change its orbital altitude because of a free-floating object in space for fear of damage to the satellite. And that object was my wire tie that I had lost, was floating around and had an impending collision with some type of satellite that was important to somebody, and they actually had to change the orbital altitude of that satellite in order to create a greater distance or miss distance between those two objects. And something as small as a wire tie could destroy an entire module on the space station, or even cause catastrophic damage to any piece of equipment in space.
Of course, this issue with debris goes far beyond a few mishaps with astronauts losing hold of things while on EVA. NASA has a pretty good track record on the vast majority of spacewalks. Everything that's carried out is carried back inside. The real problem is that debris has been accumulating in orbit around Earth ever since the space race began with the launch of Sputnik in 1957. By 1979, debris from satellites and failed rockets were already posing enough of a problem that NASA created the Orbital Debris Program to monitor the accumulating number of small objects that could cause damage to spacecraft. This program uses a network of ground-based and space-based observation techniques, like the US Air Force Space Surveillance Network, which can keep track of larger objects in space, while ground-based radar, like the Goldstone Solar System Radar, can detect much smaller objects. Of course, it would be impossible to keep track of all the debris. Today, there are 23,000 objects larger than a softball orbiting Earth, 500,000 1-centimeter-sized fragments, and over 100 million microfragments that are 1 millimeter or slightly larger. So, computer models have been developed to log and track space debris, which alerts controllers when a collision becomes a threat and allows avoidance maneuvers to be performed. The ISS has a risk management system when a potential collision is detected. The ISS has an imaginary box drawn around it, 50 kilometers squared and 0.75 kilometers deep. This acts as an exclusion zone, and any tracked debris that could pass through it will send an alert to mission control. From there, careful risk analysis begins. If there is a 1 in 10,000 to 1 in 100,000 chance of collision, the ISS receives a yellow warning, which means flight controllers must perform avoidance maneuvers if they do not interfere with mission objectives. That can be as simple as interfering with microgravity experiments. If there is a greater than 1 in 10,000 risk, then a red warning is received, and the International Space Station must take action, regardless of mission objectives. These exclusion zones exist for all satellites in NASA database. For example, in March 29, 2012, an automated email alert was sent to the Fermi Gamma Ray Space Telescope team, informing them of a predicted incursion between Fermi and Cosmos 1805, a retired Russian spy satellite, where the two would pass within 200 meters of each other, forcing them to abandon their mission temporarily and point their thrusters, which were designed to deorbit the satellite, in the direction of travel, performing a 1-second burn to prevent a potential collision. Even the smallest bits of debris, like a piece of paint, travel at speeds fast enough to do serious damage if they hit a rocket or the ISS, and tracking debris this small is impossible, which is why we need debris shields, like the one dropped in 2017, which ironically became debris itself. However, the debris shield was a relatively large and light object, helping it deorbit quicker as atmospheric drag still exists at this altitude, forcing the ISS to perform regular boost burns to maintain its orbit. Feustel says it's also much harder to lose heavier objects while working outside the space station.
You know, for a large object that weighs 800 pounds, if you let go of it with no tether on it, it's not going to go anywhere. Even if you bump it with your hand, it's not going to go anywhere because you can't put enough force into it to actually move it. But something like a wire tie, which is a small metal wire, that's super easy that if you just flick it with your fingertip or bump it, that thing's just going to go cruising away much faster than you can reach out and grab it.
But it's not only the risk of collision that causes problems when an astronaut loses something in space. There's also the issue of whether or not that tool had replacements on the space station. Consider the lost shield again. Something that weighs 8 kilograms doesn't sound very large, but when you factor in the cost of rocket launches, every kilo counts. At least in the case of the wire tie Feustel lost, there were others available on the space station. And ultimately, the rogue wire tie didn't cause any damage, though Feustel says it can still be a little blow to an astronaut's perfect record.
You lose style points for losing things in space. It's probably possible to find this out, to do a web search and find out when I lost my wire tie. And I remember saying something like, well, I'm going to have to live with this for the rest of my life, knowing that I dropped something in space, because up until that point, I had a pretty good record. I had gone without dropping anything at all. And then this last act of misfortune was my contribution to items floating in space that shouldn't be. So it's more of a style thing. Nobody looks dead. It doesn't reflect negatively, I don't think, on your spacewalking career, but it's certainly something that we all strive to not do. And you don't want to be the person who's constantly losing things. In fact, if you were somebody who constantly lost things, both in training and in space, you probably wouldn't be doing spacewalks out on orbit.
Dropping a tool in space is not something any of us have to worry about on a daily basis, but having the right tool for the job and knowing how to use it can make or break a project. Keysight put the very best tools in engineers' hands and are holding a virtual event for electrical engineers and science enthusiasts on the 14th of March. That's 3 days from now, so sign up quickly with the link in the description. This fantastic free event is a rare opportunity to learn about electronics from experts. The event on the 14th will discuss common circuit board rules of thumb and test them with Keysight's modern tools. For example, what happens to the electrical performance of a 50-ohm circuit board trace when it's dipped in liquid nitrogen? They'll compare their real-world board measurements to simulations and dig into concepts every electrical engineer should understand. This isn't just a live video you can watch and learn from. There will be a Q&A session too, allowing you to ask industry experts questions, and everyone that registers for the event will be entered into a draw for Keysight's massive gear giveaway. They are giving away 20 pieces of pro-grade test gear, including 6 GHz 8-channel oscilloscopes. These are extremely valuable professional-grade tools, and you'll get an extra entry to the giveaway if you sign up with my link. If you missed this event, don't worry, because you can rewatch the stream, and they will be holding new live events every 2 months, with the next event planned for May 16th. Whether you're an expert engineer or electronics newbie, you should definitely be signing up for this completely free event.